some degree of interest in supporter takeovers, either working on it or succeeded in it. But I'm sure there'll be others that are kind of contemplating it, which is always good. What's great for me is I don't have to do too much speaking here because the two stars of the show, Oliver and Louise, who you meet in a minute, I will tell you all about their case studies. And then we can have a discussion after each one, and then if we've still got time, go into some of the like broader issues if people want to, or we can catch up afterwards. I'm sure kind of you guys, because you're here, have got a grasp of the fact that supporter ownership is interesting, there's lots of it, and thankfully there's a decent spike in terms of numbers as well. So SD is probably known, was set up around 2000, and this spikes year on year the number of clubs that we've helped become supporter owned or community owned clubs. Now I think there's certainly been a change of focus in the last 3 or 4 years in particular, where we've realised that we needed to change the way that we operated so that we had more flexible resource, let's say, to help supporters to turn these clubs into supporter-run clubs, because of the sheer time and weight and knowledge that goes into making it happen. So we're constantly learning about ways we can do that, and also trying to fight for funding to help support these takeovers happen. But clearly, they only happen without a huge body of volunteer time, expertise, knowledge at local level. And you know, we're really there just to try and steer and link up as best we can. So that's just a bit of the context, and we're hoping that spike to go up again next year, or at least be around about that level. There's another side which we could show, which has got a map now, and it's gradually just looking like a load of splodges on the UK, which we want to kind of make it so that no one can understand where that place is. We're doing well on the M4 corridor, so I'm very pleased that Oliver's here to talk about that, but we need a few more in the northeast, so no pressure, Joe, from Hartlepool. Without further ado, I'll get Oliver to talk about fantastic achievement at Bath City. Oh, sorry, just one more thing I should say. My colleague Andrew is streaming this on Facebook. We found this is a really good way to obviously get it out there, and more people to watch it who can make it today. If that causes a problem, we can stop that, or certainly when it gets to discussion, if you're just aware of that's happening, you know. And
do you mean mind your language, James?
I mean, mind your language. I mean, mind you. So I wouldn't say unpleasantries about. If needs be, we can always, you know, cut the discussion. But you know, we're open, we're transparent. This is SD and the Sports Trust, so I'm sure of you. So without further ado, it's Oliver Holtzway from Bath City.
Actually, maybe if I stand there, and then I can stand.
Yeah.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for having me today. It's a real pleasure to speak to you all. Can I just do a quick show of hands? Who here is from a supporter-owned club at the moment? There's a couple, and who is sort of looking at trying to do it soon? Okay, yeah, excellent. Okay, I mean, the title of the presentation is From Supporter Ownership to Community Ownership. As I'll explain in a minute, we became a community-owned club 2 months ago. So we finally achieved it after 2 years of trying, but we were actually owned by our supporters since 2003. So there are differences between the two, and I think our tale can explain a lot of, you know, the limitations of simple supporter ownership versus community ownership. Get started. I'm from the Bath City Football Club Supporter Society. That's the name of our trust, and we've been around since 2003. We now have 620 members, and just for comparison, our average gate is about 600 mm-hmm. as well. It's not the same people, obviously, but. That's roughly our average game. Very brief history of Bath City Football Club, founded in 1889, so we're a very, very old club. We've played at Taunton Park since 1932. Taunton is a working class suburb of Bath. I mean, Bath is probably mostly known for Jane Austen and tourism, the very posh part, but we do have other suburbs. up until the 60s and 70s, that was a thriving working class hub with around Twerton Mill, and that supported the football club. Since deindustrialization, that has become one of the most deprived areas of the southwest, if not the country. Our natural level, so to speak, is we were a conference club for most of our existence. These days, we find ourselves on between the National League Premier or the Southern League. We currently play in National League South. That's sort of about our level. We have a long history of supporters bailing the club out. I've actually read the club history, Stars and Stripes, the West Stripes, and even since the 1920s, there were points where the supporters club was having to go and raise money to make sure we could field a team for the next season. There's a very long history of the club turning to the supporters and saying, please, can you help us, please, can you bail us out? The one before last, so to speak, was in 2003. A corporate investor owned a little bit over half the club. They were hoping to, I guess, realize, they'd sell the ground and convert it to flats. The fans were given a chance to buy them out, and they did. So the massive fundraiser went on for a year, and we were able to, before my time actually, but you know, fans were able to buy that 51% share and make the club supporter-owned. But it was supporter-owned. It was not cooperatively owned. It was not community-owned. It was a one share, one vote. It just happened that the people who owned the shares were all supporters. That was their motivation. So it still continued on normal kind of company law lines. If you look at the ownership structure, so this is 2014, this is in the aftermath of that takeover, leading up to where we were before the latest bid. The blue bit is the society. So we, in that fundraiser, bought about 18% of the club. That share was all run according to democratic principles. We had a director on the board as part of the shareholders' agreement. You could say that the rest of it was all supporters, but actually, what actually happened was the red block, which is 50% plus one, was about five people who had put in much larger sums of money. You know, supporters doing it for the good of the club. They were made up most of the board, and they were the volunteers who were really running the club on a day-to-day basis. The yellow minority shareholders was maybe 500 people who had bought 50 quid worth of shares, 100 quid worth of shares. So who, in theory had their voice at AGM, could vote. But that was about it. Like, all they could really do was, they could always be outvoted by the majority shareholders. Towards 2014, we started to enter what we call a quiet crisis, because we didn't really run to the papers and start saying that we're about to go bust. But behind the scenes, the club had been surviving on directors' loans for quite some time. So the same people who owned the majority stake were lending money into the club to keep it afloat, or to keep it at conference up level. We got debts to about £1 million. We were getting to that sort of point. And really worryingly, we had some pressing debts from former directors that were falling due of May 2015, and we didn't really have a plan on how we were going to pay those debts. So the club, we were quiet about this, but the club was facing a bit of a cliff. We've been losing money for a very, very long time, and essentially, the directors were really spending most of their time just fighting fires, making sure the batman's paid, making sure the players are being paid. There was no space, really. There weren't enough hands on deck to actually create any sense of strategic vision or a plan for growth. It was just simply keeping the wheels falling off. And that created some internal division. There's a bit of animosity between society and other parts of the board and other parts of the fan base. We own our ground, by the way. So we do own our ground. It's worth a lot of money. It's fast, so we're worth £4 or 5 million, depending on who you ask. But there's no really obvious option for us to relocate that was popular with the fans. There's not a lot of land available in Bath, certainly not a lot of flat land available in Bath. So there's no real obvious place where we could just simply go and move. So in November 2014, the majority shareholders made a public appeal that went up on the club website saying, we need new investors. We can't just simply keep lending money all the time. We've hit our limit. Someone else has to come in and take ownership or invest money in the club to keep it going. At this point, the supporter society, we offered to do that. We offered to raise money. We said, what's your price? But when we raise the money and when we give it to you, we want community ownership. We want to take control of the club. It's not going to be another simple bailout where we carry on and kind of kick the can down the road another 10 years. this has to be a complete radical change of model in how we're actually run to it more, get a cooperative community ownership model. Why do we feel this? I mean, this is our kind of preaching to the choir, absolutely, but in better governance, we felt, greater chance of being financially stable, simply because you haven't got that director's loan, kind of short-term loan option, point is technically available to you, but it's much less likely in a corporate structure. We felt it would be a better connection between the club and its fans, from, you know, having spoken to other community-owned clubs in the build-up to this. Having that democracy, transparency, and beyond transparency, some openness, a sense that you're invited to be involved. The door is always open to you to volunteer for this or stand for this committee. The door is open. And finally, a better connection between the club and the community in Bath. So that's why we felt we had to change the whole ownership model, the whole structure of how the club was governed, not just do another fail-out. So we approached this by doing a crowdfunding campaign. It was branded as the Big Bath City Bid. We had two goes at this. I was like, well, we use community shares. I'm not going to go into detail on this. If you want to talk about this at the end, that's great. But yeah, I'm happy to do that, but I won't go through all the nuts and bolts of community shares now. I'll just say the reason we chose community shares was that when you try to raise funds in community shares, you have to say to the people that you're asking money for, you have to show them your business plan for paying them back. So it's not just a bailout or a donation, say the club kind of grabbing the tin. You're saying, give us this much money, and here's how we'll pay you back. So you have to, it imposes a kind of business plan discipline. That was one of the major reasons why we chose community shares. And also, they are one member, one vote. So despite the fact that, you know, people have put in all different kinds of money, but you don't distort that basic corporate principle of one member, one vote. Those are the two main reasons. I'm happy to answer questions about this at the end. We had two goes at this. In 2015, we ran a three-month campaign. It did not work, it was a noble failure, we say. Our target was 750K, we raised 306. In 2016, we had another go. In 1 month, in September 2016, we had a target of 300K, and we raised 365K. That was successful. I'll go into just very briefly the differences between the two attempts. Obviously, the target much higher than the first attempt. Had we achieved that target, we would have immediately converted the club to a community benefit society. It would have been fully community owned in the way that FC United are, AS Wimbledon. We would have paid off a much larger chunk of debt up front. And finally, the strategic decisions about what we did about the problem we were in would have been made after the bid, cooperatively, as a community. We knew we had to do something around either redeveloping the ground and possibly moving, although, as I say, there weren't really obvious choices. Maybe installing 3G pitch, what have you. But we said, you know, we will decide that democratically as members. That was not enough of an appeal for people to actually put the money in that we needed. In the second attempt a year later, we agreed in an outline way with the existing board that we would redevelop our ground and pay off our debt that way. So we have a fairly big footprint in Twerton. We were going to tear down our grandstand, rebuild something else. We agreed that that was basically how we would approach things. So anyone who was buying into community ownership at that point was essentially buying into that being the plan. So we sort of gave away a bit of democracy, but sort of gave a bit more of a concrete vision of the future in that second attempt. We also had, this is very, very important, people who have been interested in the first attempt then offered us £350,000 of very friendly term finance, so debt-free finance for about 3 or 4 years. That would serve as working capital up until we were able to redevelop the ground and release all that equity. I mean, that's pretty major help, obviously, having people find that it won't be available to every club. But it meant we could go ahead with a target of £300,000. That would get us, however, a majority stake with society, not full conversion to total, a cooperative model. And it would be achieved by increasing our share issue. So yes, the headline big is £365,000 raised from over 620 investors and donors. That left us with a majority stake in Bath City Football Club, and that stake is democratically controlled by an open membership. It's open to anyone, not just people who put in money for the shareholding. Any of you today could join and vote and be a part of our membership. And just quickly, our ownership structure now, so we increased the shares to 800,000. We bought all those shares, so now 55% is the society. The former majority shareholders have a golden share of 25.1%, I guess, and the minority shareholders are the other part now. We have, there are 9 directors of the football club, we appoint 6 of those. And from next year, we will actually have them elected by our membership. So we have a majority on the board, and we choose the chair. So that was quite a technical analysis, I guess, of how the deal actually went through. How do we actually do this? How do we actually achieve this? How do we convince people in Bath and beyond? We have people from the United States, from Italy, and France putting money in. What were the factors that led to our success? There's 3, really. One is having a good team. When we first started on this journey, we did not have the skill set in place, the experience in place to make this happen. The existing trust board and volunteers at the time didn't have that capability, I'd say. And in between us starting in January and this picture, which is when we launched the first prospectus on June the 2nd, 2015, we had brought in a lot more people from local Bath society, from businesses, from local organizations, who were attracted to what we wanted to achieve for the club and for the city, who were bringing in legal experience, business owners, cooperative experts, social media experts, marketing people. We were able to develop a much stronger team before we actually launched. So I think that's a really key thing if you're looking at this journey, you're saying, be honest, look at your team and say, do we have what it takes now to make this happen? If not, where can we find people locally who can actually take us over the edge and run a really professional, successful campaign? We had a good story, and it was a different story. I think, Bath City for a very long time have been kind of the butt of the jokes in Bath for a while. You may be aware we have a very large rugby club, which is very successful in Bath, and that tends to take most of the attention. So we were sort of this languishing out in Twerton, sort of slightly drab, failings, just kind of hanging on club. And we were able to reposition this and say, well, actually, there's a real opportunity here for Bath. We're able to turn it around and say, a community football club, of course, but also something that could really be at the heart of the city, as opposed to being outside in the suburbs, mentally, not physically moving in. But also, we try to tap into the pride that people in Bath have about Bath. We use this line, give Bath the football club it deserves. We have a great rugby team, we have 2 great universities, there's a great restaurant scene, great cultural festival, all that kind of stuff. People in Bath are proud to be from Bath, are proud to live in Bath. And let's try and get some of that civic pride behind the club. And I think a lot of people really respond to that. And finally, good advice. I mean, we
only let them do this.
Yeah, I'm slightly biased because I'm now on the board of Supporters Direct, but I feel that we don't say this enough, that actually we could not have done it without Supporters Direct. They helped us through the prospectus process. I mean, from day one, just giving us advice, connecting us to other clubs, and particularly helping us through the prospectus process at a very reasonable discounted rate, consultancy absolutely wouldn't have been possible to achieve that support. So what's next? Like I say, we've been community-owned for almost 2 months. I mean, we've been acting like that for longer, maybe 6 months, we've been having kind of shadow board meetings. What's next? What's the plan? Well, the first thing we did was to ask the supporters what they want to see, which might sound actually a bit counterintuitive. So we just run this massive campaign saying, here's our prospectus, here's community ownership, this is what we believe in, here's our business plan. And people gave us £365,000 in it. So you might think we have a green light to carry on, as we said, but we thought, well, actually, we don't know why people put money in. So we've got our prospectus, but we don't know what they really want. We don't know how much it was, I want to save the club and that's it. I want to help the club and that's it. Or I want to help the community of Bath, and that's my main driver. Like, we didn't know this. We couldn't assume that our prospectus had the answer to all those questions. We organized a research survey with an independent volunteer social researcher, both online and offline. We asked fans, the major themes were, how do you want the club to be run? Like, how much democracy day in, day out do you actually want to see? What do you want the club to stand for? Do you even think clubs should stand for things? Like, what are our values, so to speak? And what are the major changes that you want to see at Bath City before that? We had over 550 responses. We were hoping for about 200, and within a week we had over 400, and by the end of it we had over 550 responses. And we also ran a focus group of 15 supporters just to capture anything that maybe wasn't kind of captured through the survey that we had written. And then we fed this into a vision and value session that was delivered by a local brand agency who were happy to do that for free, with the idea being that we can then have a set of values that guide where we make decisions at the Pelco Fellows. I'll quickly give you some of the priorities that came back to you with us. Most important goals for the club to strive for, being financially sustainable for the long term. Engage with the city and attract new support. Play attractive, ambitious football, of course. But that's third. Number one, clearly the fans get that we have to be financially sustainable for the long term. I think we all breathed a sigh of relief when we saw that coming top. The most essential qualities for Bath City in 5 years' time, professionally run. We were slightly surprised that was number one. Spend within its means. And ambition to climb the leagues. We thought that might be the top one. Most important qualities to me personally. So we asked people, what do you think is most important for Bath? But what's important for you? Plays attractive football, number one. Professionally run, number two. And three, ambition to climb the leagues. In fact, attractive football is above ambition to climb the leagues. Again, it's slightly reassuring. Most important changes I'd like to see in 5 years' time. The number of loss making, increased attendances, and playing the higher league. In terms of the democracy bit, how important is it that fans should have a say in their own clubs? Basically, almost everyone says at least somewhat important, and actually, a fair chunk said it's very important. But then, how much say do you like to have in the club's affairs day in, day out? 55% said key issues, but actually, we don't want to get too much into the detail of how things work. 4 in 10 said actually just let the board get on with it. Just, if we were left with you, just get on with it. And only 6% were sort of saying actually we want to have a say about things like ticket prices. We drew that a bit further. And it's really the thing around redeveloping the ground and the major financial issues of what people are concerned about. There wasn't a huge amount of voting on which pie fillings you had. There wasn't a huge appetite for that. How will we try to achieve all that? First steps, the redevelopment we're planning, which will hopefully take 4 or 5 years, that will clear the debts, we hope. So we'll be a debt-free club. How can we reverse the underlying trading position that we're loss-making? How do we move back to profitability? We appointed a general manager, slightly controversially, because it costs us money to do that. So people think you're losing money and you're paying an extra salary, but we never had that before. But we felt that was a very important investment to turn investment in turning the club around, having someone full-time developing all the income streams that volunteers alone can do. We created a working group structure for the volunteers. We have 6 different working groups up there, each chaired by a board member. So in terms of the way we recruit volunteers, we're becoming a bit more sophisticated and actually having a structure for them to work. And that's been successful so far. We created a volunteer partnerships officer role. We actually have 2 people. I'm one of them, one of the partnerships person. We have 2 people volunteering whose job it is to get more volunteers and to manage volunteers and make sure that they're happy. I think that, well, it's early days, but we thought that's probably quite important. You can't rely on it to kind of naturally happen. We created a communications manager role, again, on a volunteer basis. We are working on upgrading our website and our ability to sell online and our basic IT in the office. And we're reviewing how we do our food and drink, what's on offer at the stadium. And also the commercial offer, I guess, to businesses. So that's where we are, and that's where we're going. So yeah, happy to take any questions, or I don't want to do both positions first. Or
I was thinking about that. I'm happy to do. Should we do questions now, or do you want to hear from Foundation Hearts? Because some of it will cross over, and some of it will just be thin, got strong.
Did you think because there are so many people obviously who had clearly from the responses an ambition to go up the leagues, did you ever consider, well, maybe the quickest way to do that would be to have a larger portion of the ownership be private companies or something like that, if that was something that was important to a lot of people? Because I know Pompey, for example, have considered, and like that was the reason why they were going to sell off, because they wanted basically to speed up the leagues more quickly.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the quick answer is that there was no such money forthcoming. There was no one queuing up to buy a massive share of Bath City and plow loads of money into it. And I think it's probably fair to say that we were the last resort. I think it's probably fair to say that. I can't speak for the former majority shareholders, but I think they really turned to us as the last resort. Whether down the line someone comes waving a checkbook at us, it'll be up to the fans to decide, I guess. But certainly as society members, we felt if you do that, you only end up having to do it again in 50 years, you know, it's only, or 20 years. You know, it's, we felt the best long-term way of doing it was the popular one.
Lisa? Can I just ask what the effect was, if any, on the sort of culture of the place when you did this? Did you notice anything different? And I'm including the players in that, but everything. And secondly, did it have any effect on the league or the way other clubs looked at Bath City, the fact that you were under in a slightly different situation?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think in terms of the culture, just having the bid happening brought a lot of new faces and new energy into the club. So in the one sense, I think even among the broader fan base, there's a feeling of cautious optimism or hopefulness around the club, whereas I think for a very long time it just simply seemed more of that. So at a general level, that's true. However, I mean, I think it's probably unsurprising to hear that, you know, bringing new faces in doesn't necessarily, you know, that can create cultural problems in its own place. I think we're still in the process now of working through how new and old work together, and so far it's very positive, but you can sort of see the possible tensions around that. It was probably part of the reason why we did the research and looking at, you know, our values, so to speak, is to try and create a common ground between all the new. It's not a situation where you have, you know, a single owner who's sort of bought out and just disappears onto his yacht. I mean, you're still working shoulder to shoulder with the people who were there before. In terms of the legal other clubs, I'm not sure, to be honest. Yeah, I don't know. Probably too early to say.
Yeah, I'll just add quickly to that. From the outside, as a campaign, yours stood out there as good as any I've seen. You know, the Big Bath bid, those meet people, I'm not saying it's a video, but the people that you brought in that bid, it was just incredible. It was like the who's who of Bath, wasn't it? But it also had a lot of credibility. But one of the, you know, the town hall meeting was fantastic. It was all so brilliantly put together. So there's two things for me there. It's like retaining, well, one thing that really excited me was that you said a quiet crisis. There were some issues. It was a bit fiddly what you were trying to actually do, wasn't it? But there's so many clubs that we talk to that, you know, they want the crisis to get that sort of reaction. So I thought that was amazing that you got all that, you know, from what was a kind of bit of reorganisation. What I'm interested is how you maintain all that kind of almost like cross-city support and interest, to take it into, you know, a rainy Tuesday night in Market, or wherever you can retain that, because if you do, you're onto something pretty special, I think.
Yeah, no, thank you very much. I mean, actually, we were fortunate to have one of our major supporters, as Ken Loach, the film director. So we had, you know, Eric Cantona doing a, you know, a box pop, you know, support thing, was Ruby Thomason as well. So we were able to get there, and, you know, the Bath great and good sort of took an interest for the first time in a long time, I think, in the football club. And yeah, as you say, it was an odd sell. Certainly the first time around, people weren't quite sure what we were selling. So we weren't selling Save the Club, we weren't selling It's Disaster, we weren't selling this or horrible weirdism. It was just sort of, well, you better if it's community, right? Well, okay, it could be new. I think actually having that sense of we're going to tear this down and build something there, it just gives you a bit more of a kind of crunchy, you know, approach on it. Now, how do you keep that interest going? I mean, my role at the club at the moment as a volunteer is partnerships manager, and which basically means building institutional links with the universities, with local trade associations or industry associations, building a slightly stronger infrastructure like that. So, you know, that post kind of bid buzz, the post takeover buzz, will not last you that long, I think. I mean, you can work really hard at making sure, on an institutional level and a personal level, that you're really making an effort to reach out to different parts of Bath, you know, making sure that there's a Bath City element to the festivals that we have in Bath, or, you know, just making sure you're marketing the whole touch point. outwards, but yeah, making sure that there's a path city in all those kind of places. Mm-hmm. So that's what I was trying to do. But like I say, I mean, we're 2 months in, so we sort of can't say that these are things that are going to work. But I'd be interested to hear what other people are doing in terms of how they're setting up their community.
They're calling it a community ownership. Make it easier. Sell. I know you dropped the target by half.
Mm.
But calling it a community ownership, would that make it an easier sell?
We called it that from the outset. It was called community ownership both times. In terms of the bits. So yes, that helps. People went up, community, club, ownership, yep, that sounds good. That, yeah. Actually, we were lucky as well because there was a pub in Bath the year before, a very much loved pub, had become community owned. So people in Bath were somewhat, you know, we could say, oh, it's like for them, we're doing it for the pub, but it's and people just knew, oh, we don't understand that. So people got that, responded to it, but I think that didn't answer the question of, well, how are you going to not lose money? How are you not going to, yeah, you're in debt, how are you going to pay off the debt? I think you're having a bit more of a, you know, a clearer plan for that, I think actually helped. I think. Sorry, did I answer your question?
Yeah, gotcha.
Yeah, just a quick one. I was interested in the transition between supporter owned to community owned, just in terms of the numbers I explained it. So you had 5 supporters that own 51% of the club, and then they've now got 25% between them, is that right?
Yeah, just over, yeah.
Okay. And so then there's 600 investors and donors that have got 365k for 51% of the club. Is that just is something that's recognised by Supporters Direct in terms of, like, is it the numbers or is it the sort of mechanism you've gone through to make it a community owned one that makes it a community-based club? It's just like you could technically say we've got 600 fans now that own 51% of the club,
yeah,
rather than 5. So yeah, it's like just a change in the volumetrics, isn't it?
So we do have a definition, and it obviously does sometimes get tested, but the key bit is, for these guys, the majority of the shares in this case are obviously with the Supporters Trust, and within the Supporters Trust constitution, they have to be inclusive, so essentially £10 a year, what's your membership fee? Like that, yeah. £5 bargain. So £5 a year, you're effectively majority control of the club. So that's the key bit is,
yes, it's one number one vote. Exactly. Yeah. I think that's the thing. Because, you know, before there were, you know, 5 people owning 51%, and yeah, 400, 500 each owning small shares, but that wasn't giving them a lot of say. So they could always be outvoted by the 51%, and through a natural process, that 51% then became the board, and they ended up running the club, and ended up becoming very isolated because they were the only ones who were doing it. Whereas, yeah, it's not so much the number of members, it's the fact that the majority is owned by a cooperative trust.
Sure.
I think that's the key difference.
Understood. So if, you know, hopefully well done, and I hope it continues and you get 1,000 members and it grows and grows, but if it fell to, say, 300 members within the trust, they'd still retain that 51%.
Yes, absolutely.
That's the way it works. Yeah. That's enshrined in sort of constitution.
Oh, yeah. That's it. Yeah. Okay. It's owned by a trust which has members and not by individuals.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the key difference.
Right.
Yeah, our membership can grow and increase and we'll still retain that share.
Right.
Mm. What's the relationship between the 5 majority shareholders and the community society?
It's now, it was perhaps in the past acrimonious. Mm. I don't mind saying that on Facebook, I think it's fair to say, but there are tensions at times. Now we're working with them very well. I mean, yeah, I think on my side, there's a board of 9 people. 3 of them are drawn from the former majority shareholders. 6 are society appointees, and yeah, I mean, there's some getting used to each other, but so far it's been a really positive cooperative relationship.
So with the finance raising and the community shares, as you say, it's one member, one vote.
Mm.
That's regardless of how much people put in.
Yeah.
So is there a bit of tension there that it causes tensions? If we're all members of the trust and I've got £20 and I put that in, and Andy's richer than me and he puts in £1,000,
yeah,
we still get the same vote.
Mm-hmm.
I can see the sense of it myself, but does it cause tensions? Does in that situation, does Andy go, I'm putting in more and more, I should have more people?
It's kind of self-selecting in a way, because if you sort of feel that if I'm putting in X, 20k, I should have way more say, then you won't buy a community share, you just won't get involved.
Yeah.
So in a sense, to even buy into it, you have to kind of accept the fact that we're stronger with more people involved, because we're essentially on tier one club. It's so much more important that people feel they can have an equal say and an equal ability to contribute than me having the ability to outvote you because of what I put in. So, I mean, we've not yet had any flashpoints where that's kind of come up. But like I say, I think it's self-selecting. I mean, assuming people understand what they're buying into, it's not really a problem. I'm sure some people did say, actually, that's not for me, why would I do that?
Mm-hmm.
I'd maybe say that you could possibly say that, and other clubs might say this too, there's maybe a certain level of commitment financially where people stop being willing to put money in for one member, one vote.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's around kind of 40-50k, maybe a little lower than that. It's quite difficult to attract contributions on that on a one-on-one vote basis. We sort of saw, and I think the Bell kind of told us, the pub and battles as well. So, as I say, we had the friendly investors providing 350,000 of, and finance on very friendly terms, but I think that was probably never going to come as, there you go, for that many community shares. So, but so far no tensions, I would say.
Mm.
Have you had many, have you had many of these people buying these shares wanting their money out, and you've had to sort of look at your discretion, yes, you can have it, no, you can't have it?
We've had one person ask for it back so far. Actually, we can repay for at least 3 years, or even longer. So there is actually a locked-in period.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess it's first up, I didn't realise that. That's the other one we've heard of so far. I think it'll be a bit further down the line when it happens.
Mm-hmm.
It's true. I mean, it's not that, community shares are very funny. They're such an amazing tool in many ways, but they're really confusing. And I just think, particularly because it's not really shares. So I think it'll be interesting to see down the track how many people who bought them really fully understood the perspectives. And obviously, on camera here, we had our community shares prospectus signed off by the community shares unit. It has a character community shares mark of best practice. So we did everything. We had to go 12 rounds with a lawyer to get that out there. So it's completely legit. But when you think about people's motivations for buying into it, some people will look at it as a prospectus and say, yes, I'll make a bit of interest back, I want to help my community. Some people would have said, I want to help my club, my club will be to go. And perhaps we wouldn't put in as much money if we just shake it in. We don't really know that. So we'll see when it comes to the repayment time whether how well people really understood the minutiae or the nuances of how things actually work.
Mm. We're a year down the line in terms of supporter ownership, and there is still that confusion about it's the word share.
Yeah.
There is that confusion about what do you mean to share is. What we found, and you may well have found the same, is that the people that are putting in the larger amounts are the long-term supporters. At the end of the day, love their club. And even though you can, in theory, repay after 3 years, and the same lucky group, as you said, our expectation is that nobody will ever fall back in.
Mm-hmm.
So we had a lot of confusion on the original application form about if we were to pay you a dividend, for example, once we have our war chest, and hope you make a profit, what sort of percentage interest would you want? Caused a lot of confusion.
Mm-hmm.
I'd be very surprised if any of our core supporters ever call in that return, assuming we can afford to do so. But we're 12 months in, as at yesterday, and there's still confusion about what is the thing called community share.
Yeah, absolutely.
And, I mean, it's like word share.
The word share is so confusing. Even after it's already, the deal's gone through.
Yeah.
Spent having a lot of work. So, I hope that people will call in their shares, and I hope that we'll be able to afford to repay them. So that's why we chose that model. So, I'm optimistic that in time we'll be able to do that. That's very interesting. Even year on, it's still.
I'm a big Hamilton Kite Community Shares T-shirt. yet, but not far off. But yeah, one of the things that a lot of insight, that discipline of putting it together in the process. You're gonna do a brilliant campaign like these guys did. You know, it's getting out there and it will get unpicked. You know, so it was brilliant, got loads of publicity, loads of support. And it looked like the best business plan that probably any club and conference staff has put together in the last 10 years. And then it's something that is a guiding principle for everyone who commits time and works on, you know, for the board. It's all about, for me, getting it's more information into the public domain about how football clubs should be run, and I think they did a fantastic job. So just wary of time, but so thanks so much to Oliver and all your team, because it's been inspirational for our fellow clubs.